Awesome is who you are. yourself mighty.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. He's already shown himself. Come on, let's go higher.
Hallelujah.
Y'all serve a big God.
Yes.
I know he's big to me. My God is big, so strong, so mighty, yeah. My God plans for me.
Mighty, mighty, mighty God we serve.
Woo!
nothing my God cannot do. Yeah, yeah, yeah. There's nothing my God cannot do.
My God. Nothing my God cannot do. Can I just show y'all what God's showing me? Can I just show y'all what God's showing me? You keep hearing, when you think of food, you think of something that you desire, then it's good. And every time you keep saying, you get full. But if you eat too much food, it's called a glut. But he said, you can continue to take this goodness. Yeah. And just like food, when you start getting full, you feel it right here. This right here, I feel it right here. But he said, you can keep on getting that goodness. You can keep on saying, you ain't got to stop eating this. You ain't got to stop right here. When it start hurting, you can still say, You can still say,
I want you to stand with me. You don't get off that easy. It ain't that easy. It ain't that simple. Yeah, let the Lord speak to you, because that's what he wants to do right now, right where you are. Matter of fact, I want you to grab your neighbor's hand. Yeah, grab that hand. Let your neighbor know I'm going to pray for you. Yeah. Yeah, you ain't going to get away this time. You're not going to leave this place without connecting with me this Sunday. Because we have a tendency as religious people is coming in and getting what we want and exiting left. Oh, but you ain't going to leave without connecting with me this Sunday. Because you need to know something about your neighbor. Your neighbor came through the storm this morning. Yeah, they fought to get here. The devil did everything he could to keep your neighbor from getting here this morning. So tell your neighbor, I'm going to pray for you. Yeah, you overcame some stuff to get here this morning. And if ain't nobody else in the world praying for you, you know you got a brother, you got a sister praying for you this morning. Yeah, yeah. Because you shouldn't have made it through that storm. You shouldn't have came through the stuff that you've gone through. You shouldn't have made it, neighbor, but I'm going to pray for you. Yeah, I'm glad that you made it. I'm not going to overlook you this morning. Let me tell you a little bit about your neighbor, that hand that you're holding. Yeah, that hand that you're holding, it almost quit. That hand that you're holding almost gave up. So let them know I'm here for you. Yeah, you ain't got to quit. I felt the same way. I wanted to quit, not last year, but last week. Yeah, I thought about giving up last night. Neighbor, I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to pray for you. Yeah, you know you got a friend in me. Yeah, 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 I got your back. What you need to understand, neighbor, if the devil try to get to you, he got to get through me in order to get to you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, let it out. They Sunday. That's why you came. You know the Lord is releasing some revelation on your behalf. And the Lord is going to release it through your neighbor this morning. You don't even deserve it. You don't even deserve it. But he loves you that much. That's how much he loves you. Yeah. He loves you in spite of the stuff that you've done. Unconditionally. He loves you even with some of the stuff that you're thinking about doing. That's how much he loves you. And I'm going to be the conduit. I'm going to be the connector this morning. I'm going to connect you with heaven this morning. So you will know that you're not by yourself. Yeah, I know you done come through some tough stuff, but you're not the only one. I've been through some tough stuff too. I know what it feel like to want to quit. I know what it feel like to want to give up. Yeah, you got a friend in me, brother. You got a friend in me, sister. Yeah, I got you covered. I got you covered. You might have came in this place broken, but you gonna leave whole. I got you covered. Yeah, yeah. You ain't gonna quit. You ain't gonna give up. I ain't gonna let you quit. I ain't gonna let you give up. I love you too much. Yeah, yeah. You done come through too much already. The devil ain't gonna have the last say so in your life. I'm gonna stand in the gap for you. Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah, let them know that you love them. Let them know that you love them. That love is real. You can count on me. You can count on me. You can count on me. Ha. Yeah, I'm here for you. I'm here for you. I'm here for you. The stuff I went through was for you. I'm here for you. The stuff I went through for you. I'm here for you. I had to pay for this. And all you doing is paying for it. He wants you to return the favor. He wants you to be a conduit so he can return the favor through you. Yeah, Candebo say, heal me, Lord. Right now, I need a healing. My heart has been broken, Lord. I need you to heal me. I need you to hear my cry. I need you to hear my cry. I dare you to cry out to him. I need you to hear my cry. I'm hurting and I need you to hear my cry. Don't leave me. Don't leave me out here by myself. I need you to hear me. Respond to my cry. Respond to my pain. Respond to my problem. Respond to my situation. Don't leave me the same way that you found me. Lord, I need you. Hear my cry. Hear my cry. Oh, Lord, help us right now. He say he has not forgotten about you. He's not forgotten about your labor of love. You love some people that didn't love you back. He say, I didn't forget about you. You sacrificed when nobody would sacrifice for you. He say, I have not forgotten about you. Yeah. You wanted to divorce her. You wanted to divorce him. And you had a right to, but to stand right there. So, Lord, I'm praying for my brother. I'm praying for my sister that you heal them right where they are right now in the name of Jesus. Your healing power is available to us right now. Your anointing is here to remove every burden and to destroy every yoke. Let your power be made evident in this place right now in the name of Jesus. Yeah. He's doing it right now. He don't need no preacher to do it. All he needs is your praise. If you can praise him, he'll bypass the preacher. If you can praise him, if you can give him the sacrifice of praise, he will bypass flesh and blood just to get to you. I dare you to praise him. I dare you to worship him. I dare you to know that nobody can do me like you can. I've looked to the right and I looked to the left. I ain't found nobody that can do me the way that you do me. Yeah. I'm leaving this place empowered. I'm not leaving this place timid or fearful. You have not given me a spirit of fear, but the spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. Yeah, bring some soundness to my mind. Don't allow me to function in chaos not one other day. Bring some soundness to my mind. I'm praying for my neighbor, Lord. My neighbor needs you right now. Invade their territory right now in the name of Jesus. Yeah, invade their space right now. Make their flesh uncomfortable. Have them to do something they didn't come expecting to do because your spirit has shown up in this place. Yeah. Just go ahead and worship him. Just go ahead and worship him. You are in the right place. Just go ahead and worship him. This is what you came for. You didn't come to hear a man. You came to receive what God has for you. Just go ahead and worship him. Now that you have his attention, he is turning your way. What is it that you want him to do for you? He said, let your request be made known. Yeah. decisions that it, there's some decisions getting ready to be made because you prayed for your neighbor. They didn't come expecting you to bring the deliverance. They didn't come expecting you to bring the word. But your neighbor is powerful. And as long as you stay connected, you're going to be all right. Go ahead and give them a hug and tell them stay connected. Yeah, tell them to stay connected. I know it gets tough sometimes, but stay connected. I know you get tired of me sometimes, but stay connected. I know I might have a tendency to get on your nerves, but stay connected. Yeah, stay connected. Yeah, don't jump up, don't jump ship just yet. Don't leave the house. Tell your neighbor, don't leave the house. Don't leave the house. Don't leave the house. Stay in the house. Stay in the house. Stay in the house. Stay in the house. Yeah. From heart to heart and breast to breast. He's healing right now. Yeah, that's how much he loves you. Right there, that's how much he loves you. Learn to be the living expression of his word. Stop explaining to people who he is and become his expression. Allow him to touch through you. Allow him to feel the pain of your neighbor through you. Yeah, stop bypassing me. I'm hurt. And that's why he's put us in the body. So every joint will supply every other joint. He said the most feeble parts are the most necessary. I dare you to stub your toe. I dare you to jam your finger. And watch how much. I like that. And just watch how much attention that head pay to that jammed thumb or that jammed finger. And your knees get to moving. Affect the whole body. Yeah, if I hurt, you hurt. Yeah, you're not insignificant. You come through those doors, you are significant to me. Christ paid a price for you to come through those doors. I refuse to act like that you are insignificant. When your power is connected to my power, I'm only as strong as my weakest link. We are only as strong as our weakest link. Tell your neighbor, I need you. Yeah, I need you. Yeah. I refuse to be arrogant about it. The gift that God has given you, he gave you that gift for me. Let me tell you something about your gift. You really can't even enjoy your gift. Because you got to fight to keep that gift. The devil trying to steal that gift away from you. So you can't supply me with what I need. Tell your neighbor, I got a gift. And I had to fight to keep it. Yeah. For you, I fought to keep this gift for you because I knew that you were gonna need it. Yeah, I didn't slip out and do something I didn't have any business doing because I had you on my mind, because he had me on his mind. Yeah, tell your neighbor, you're in the right place. Yeah. Lord, we thank you as we lift our hands to you. Father, we prayed for our neighbor, and you've done it for our neighbor. They didn't even come expecting for you to do it the way that you've done it. Because you said in your word, the wind blows where it listed. We don't know which direction the Holy Spirit is going to move. But we know once we show up to the sanctuary, you're going to do something. We don't even know who you're going to do it through. This morning you did it through our neighbor, so we thank you for our neighbor. But Father, we come right now to let you know we didn't come to see our neighbor. If our neighbor didn't show up, we were going to be here. Because we trust you that much. Because you are worthy. You deserve our praise. Because praise is really what we do. Even when we're going through, praise is what we do. Even when we don't know how we're coming out of the stuff that we're in, praise. We have a tendency to muster up praise, and we don't even know where it comes from, because we have been created to worship. In the middle of a mess, we find a thank you, Jesus, from somewhere. When we're getting ready to give up, we find a hallelujah from somewhere. And that hallelujah has the capability of sustaining us until we find ourselves back to the sanctuary. So, Father, we thank you for our neighbor, but more than everything, more than anything, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your word that was made flesh in the person of Jesus, the Christ, the Son of the living God. So we say thank you right now for his presence. For he said, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst. And Father, you've made your presence known this morning. You've thrown your weight around this morning. You healed broken hearts this morning. You gave us beautiful ashes this morning. You gave us the oil of joy for the spirit of mourning this morning. So we say thank you right now. And Father, we pray that you get the glory out of everything that is said and everything that is done. And it is in the mighty name of Jesus that I pray. Let all the sons and daughters of God say amen. Amen. Lord, have mercy. And once you begin to learn to live life on the offense, and the reason why you begin to live life on the offense is because you find out that the devil hates you. How many of you know that the devil really hates you? That the devil was doing everything that he could to destroy you before you found out who you were. Yeah. So when you find that out, when you realize that the enemy really has tried to destroy you, that his method of operation is to steal, to kill and destroy, once you get that revelation, the feelings become mutual. Because you begin to gain a hate for him as much as he hates you, but some of us don't hate him as much as he hates us. That's the reason why some of us still sleep with him. When you continue to sleep with the enemy, it's because you have not found a hatred in him, the same kind of hatred in him that he has for you to him. Let me hear you say the feelings are mutual. Yeah, I ain't playing with him. He ain't playing with me. Yeah, the feelings are mutual. I don't even blame him for being the devil no more. I understand it. So it doesn't surprise me when he does what he does. But I found a Savior Pastor Stevenson told me I could sing a hymn this morning. And he is sweet, I know. Come on. Yeah, we need to hear that this morning. Yeah. If you know it, you might as well sing it. God, a hand clap of praise.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is.
It's all right to praise him. You don't have to stop just because the music stops. Let's go to the book of Ephesians. Chapter 4, verses 10 through 13. And we thank God for this opportunity. Lord, have mercy. Thank God for Jesus, the Holy Spirit, who is the Comforter, the Trinity, the three in one. Thank God for Pastor Stevenson and First Lady Stevenson. Pray that they had a good time up there in Alabama. Freddie had a good showing yesterday. So we thank God for what he's doing in Freddie's life and how he's preparing a platform for him that's out of this world. It's just a blessing to be a part of really the move of God. Because you know, you often hear people talk about you know, what it was like in the old days when this and that happened. But somebody say, we in it. Yeah. The book of Ecclesiastes talks about how it is better to have at your disposal a live dog opposed to having a dead lion. Have a tendency to rejoice over the stuff that took place in the past. But what is God doing now? Even though it may not appear to be significant to you, he's moving. This live dog is better than that dead lion. A live dog will whoop a dead lion any day of the week. Backwards and forwards, upside and down. I'd rather have a live dog than a dead lion. Because a lot of the stuff they talked about that lion doing, he really didn't do. All the stuff that they talk about was the good old days. It really wasn't that good. They had as many problems as we had today. Yes! Somebody got to tell the truth. Yeah, it wasn't that good. Y'all was tore up too. Y'all needed his blood just like we needed his blood. The good old days. Where did that happen? Let us get into the word. Ephesians chapter number 4, verses 10 through 13. And the Lord has really already done what he needed to do. But there are a few points that I wanted to leave with you. Because I know how important it is for us to have church. And what we call church is just tradition. You are the church. So what we want to do is equip you with the word so you can go and be the church after this here is all over. Yeah, because you can't stay here. All that shouting you just done, you can't, look, you got to go back to the real world. And you got to use these strategies that we give you. This under, you got to use this stuff. You can't take no shout to the electric, to Tico. Y'all got Tico out here. You better learn how to go to job, go to work. Tell your neighbor you need to go to work. Don't you stay in this church. Uh-oh. All right. Let us read together on ready read. 1, 2, ready read. He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens that he might fill all. Look what he done for you. First, he descended. Do you know how much he went through in order to get to you? He descended into the lower parts of the earth. Let's go to the verse 11. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. And when he descended, and when he after he descended and ascended, he brought some stuff back with him. He brought some stuff back with him that was locked up because of the disobedience of man. These gifts were not available until he descended and ascended. So when he ascended, he came back and he delivered the body with these five gifts, with these five offices. Don't you bypass that. Let's go to verse 12. And look at the reason why after he descended and after he ascended and he brought back those five. Look at what he brought the body these five gifts for. Hey, somebody ought to say. He brought these five gifts. He put these five gifts in place so that you might be made perfect. So that you might get yourself together. Tell your neighbor you need to get yourself together. Not me. Stop blaming me. And get yourself together. Yeah, because we can throw off quick, especially if we know just enough scripture, we know how to throw off on people and blame them for us not being who we say God has created us to be. Tell your neighbor, I ain't your problem. I may not even like you, but I still ain't your problem. This is the reason why he gave us these five gifts, so we can begin to gain an understanding of why we're being tripped up over the stuff we're being tripped up over. We can't be made perfect in the flesh. We can't be made perfect operating out of the traditions of men. For the perfecting, that means there is an expectation on your life. Don't you settle for wherever you are. I don't care if where you are is a good place. Don't you settle. Because you hadn't seen the fullness that God has for you because you ain't through being perfected yet. For the perfecting of the saints. Yeah, yeah, for the perfecting of the saints. And then he gives you your occupation. He's not perfecting you for you. For the work. Somebody say it's time for you to go to work. Say it like you mean it. Say it's time for you to go to work. Yeah, you've been bootlegging too long. You need to get qualified. You need to put in your application. Don't you just show up to somebody's job and expect them to pay you. Look here, you volunteering is what you're doing. Because you're definitely not going to get paid. I dare you to just show up to somebody's job and say, I'm here to work, okay? And they will work you. Yeah, we'll work you. You better know why you up in here. You better know why God has called you. You better know why God has created you for the work of the ministry. For the ministry. What is ministry? Ministry is me serving you my gift. And you can't effectively serve people that you don't love. If you don't love me, you ain't gonna care nothing about me. And you'll withhold your gift from me. Even when you know I need what God done put in you. But when I'm about ministry, I show up when you hate me. I show up even though you stab me in the back. Because it's not about me. I'm here to work. I don't know about you, but I'm here to work. Y'all see, we play hard and we work even harder. That's what this praise is all about. For the work of the ministry, for the edifying. Stop. We have to stop allowing people to put their mouth on Christ's bride. I dare you to talk to me, say anything out of the way about my wife. You belong to Christ. And Christ said, when you touch my bride, you touch the apple of my eye. I know she don't look as hot as she used to be, but she's still mine. She might come down the aisle with a tattered gown, but she's still my bride. She may not have it all together right now, but you better not touch her. Keep your mouth off his bride. This is his church. Brother, I didn't die for you. Sister, I did not die for you. He paid a significant price for you to be where you are. So I dare not put my mouth on you. He paid the price for you to be here, not us. We are the gifts that come with the bride. We are the bride's gifts, so the bride can be made perfect for the edifying of the body of Christ till we all. Tell your neighbor, say, you can't get there without me. Yeah, I know you think you are a little bit more spiritual, but you ain't getting there without me. Because he said, until we all, you got to wait on me. If I'm a little slow, if I ride the slow bus, you got to wait on me. Y'all can't start school until we get there. Till we all get there. Yeah, you better wait on me. Yeah, call me slow if you want to, but you got to wait. You got to wait on me. He ain't finna bless you and not bless me. He might bless you first, but you still got to wait on me because he ain't finished. Stay in line. Tell your neighbor, just stay in line. Yeah, I know it look like your neighbor might be a little bit farther than you, but he or she, they still got to wait. Till we all come. Until this is what the fight is all about. This word right here. That's what the fight is all about. That's why the devil wants you to stay at odds with your neighbor, with your spouse, on your job. He wants you to stay at odds with everybody so we'll never come to the unity. Unity of the faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. There's some tangible things that need to be produced out of this faith that you say that you have. And the first thing that we need to see, that the first thing that needs to manifest is unity. And of the knowledge of the Son of God. I want to know, Paul say, I want to know him. In the power of his resurrection and in the fellowship of his suffering. So don't think that you're going to be able to get this knowledge without some suffering. It's going to make you stronger. You can handle what you're going through. I know you may not want to deal with it, but you can handle it. You haven't jumped off the planet yet, have you? Somebody say, I can handle it. Don't like it, but I can handle it. And the reason why I can handle it is because what I'm going through cannot be compared to what he went through on my behalf. You have not yet suffered unto blood. You hadn't given your life for this. He gave his life. So what is your excuse? You don't have one. He has ruled all of your excuses out because he's been the perfect example of what suffering and being successful through suffering looks like. Oh, yeah, you can come out of this. Yeah, you can come out. You are coming out. Tell your neighbor, I'm coming out of this. Yeah, I found some strength from somewhere. This crazy joker done made me believe I can do anything. Because I found it in his word. I can do all things. I can do it. Because of what he did, he's already put it on display. He showed me what he's capable of doing. And then he said, greater works will you be able to do. Yeah, I'm going to empower you even the more. I'm going to say, fill me, Lord. Yeah. And the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure. Lord, have mercy. Tailor made. He's sizing me up. You've been sized up for the stuff that you got to go through. Nobody else can go through what you want, what you're going through, because you've been measured. You've been tailor-made for this particular circumstance and situation. That's why you didn't lose your mind. Yeah, you've been tailor-made for this. Of the stature of the fullness of Christ. You're going to keep on going too, ain't you, Ray? I say at 13. You making me work. 13, yeah, we're going to stay right there. And what I want to talk to you about this morning is simply the fruit of the apostolic. That's it. We have traditionalists explaining this verse away. But whenever you go to the word, don't you ever go to the word trying to figure out what it's not saying. That's confusing. That creates chaos. Just tell me what the words say. Don't give me your opinion. I know you got your commentary. I know your commentaries are good, but don't you explain away something that Christ died for, that he revealed in his word. People just try to explain stuff away for no reason. Why are you giving me information I didn't ask for? That let me know you lying. Whenever you run up on somebody that give you more information than you ask for, that joker is lying. Why is he giving you more information? So you won't hone in on what the real problem is. When people ask you questions that don't want answers, you need to be able to identify. Everybody that's asking questions don't want answers. And Jesus would always respond with a question so that you could, so he could identify whether or not you were serious about the question that you've been asking. Ask a question with a question. Stop giving up all your goods, all this revelation that God done gave you. Everybody don't want to hear this. They just trying to trip you up. Yeah, don't cast your pearls before swine. I refuse to release this kind of revelation on Facebook another day. You got to pay for this. Facebook prophets know everything. But they stuff don't work. It don't work. When they show up, it falls flat. Because they need virtual reality in order for it to stand up. You can become Superman on Facebook. I'm trying to figure out where all these hard jokers come from. Legends in their own minds. Where was I when all this happened? When did you become this? Yeah. And that is exactly what it is, a counterfeit anointing. And that virtual reality is creating space for everybody to become a superhero. Talk to me. The body needs you if you're that powerful. If you're that powerful, we need you up in here, up in here. Lord, have mercy. The fruit of the apostolic. And what you learn when you come to the sanctuary of hope is that you're gonna see the power of God expressed, opposed to us having to explain it. This is just a bonus. You done church already out. Y'all know that, right? You've come and you've already received everything that God has for you. He's just equipping you on the way out. Just giving you your weapon, giving you your ammunition on your way home. He responded to your praise. And you found out that it had nothing to do with the preacher. It had everything to do with your sacrifice. I dare you to come in here every week willing to be a sacrifice, to be a living sacrifice. He will show up every time you decide that you want. When you place a demand on the kingdom, And that demand is coming from a pure place, he's obligated to respond to it. I don't care if the preacher can't preach a lick. Put everybody in the house asleep. When you come with a sacrifice of praise, God is obligated to respond. He said, I'll come and sit right beside you. If you make your bed in hell, I'll come right there with you. I'll show up. If you say that you are following me and your following me leads you to a fiery furnace, I'll show up. Yeah, I'll break the prison doors down to get to you. That's what you call breakthrough, mama. That's how much he loves you. Yeah, he'll go through any extent to get to you if you can offer him up the sacrifice of praise. Now what Paul and Silas was in there doing. Paul, they say Paul was singing and Barnabas, Silas was giving him the beat. And they went to praising God in that place, and God heard that place supersede and went through the first. The atmospheric heaven is what we call it. The atmospheric heaven is the first heaven. This is a place where men make decisions about eternity. So it made it through the first heaven because Paul and Silas had already made a decision about eternity. Somebody say, make a decision. And then it made it through the second heaven. The second heaven is the place where the angels dwell, where there's warfare, and there are destinies made or destinies altered in the second dimension or the second heaven. But Paul say, I made it to the third heaven, to his throne room. If you learn how to get to a place where you are communing with God, your prayer can supersede the first and the second heaven and fall right at the throne of God. Paul say, I knew a man, whether he was in the body or out of the body, I can't tell. But I know a man, he heard things that are not even lawful to be uttered. Got some stuff that I can't even share with you because I don't know how to explain what I saw. Yeah, somebody say it's available. Yeah, it's available. It's available. If you begin to praise him, you can break through those different dimensions. It's evident in the word. So don't explain that away. Stop telling me what the Bible is not saying. When he's told me he's given me everything that pertains to life and godliness within these 66 books. And there are more books, but we can't even handle the 66. So how are we going to venture off into something else? Oh, you're a Hebrew Israelite now. Smoking like the Fed. Can't keep you out of the club, but you're a Hebrew Israelite. No discipline whatsoever. You just say what you want to say when you want to say it. And that's what happens when the fivefold ministry is not in place. Joker could come in and just run roughshod over the church. Because nobody is making them accountable. You're going to bring your talent and you're going to get an order up in here. Yeah, we know you're gifted. We know you're anointed, but you're going to get an order. Somebody say, get in line. Yeah. I know you can preach like Paul, but you're going to get in line. You might be able to deke with the best of them, but you're going to get in line. You might be the best usher that God has ever made, but you're going. You wouldn't take your child to a place where there was no accountability. You wouldn't drop your child off to a place where everybody's just doing what they want to do. And that's what happens when the fivefold ministry is not in operation. Everybody just do what they want to do. The choir do what they want to do. Especially the musicians, they run rough. They run through the church, through the women at the same time. And now we know that it both ways. Bring your hips in order. Yeah. Fruit of the apostolic, this is how you know that the apostolic is in place, in a place, is that it has the evidence. And we talked about this yesterday, and we talked about it this morning. The fruit is a byproduct of the root. Whatever your roots are, that's what you're going to produce. If your roots are trenched in tradition, you're going to produce what tradition can produce. You're limited to it. There's no way around it. you are limited. It's not that people that are traditional are not saved. It's just that they're limited simply because their roots define their fruit. Jesus said it like this. You hold the traditions of men up higher than you hold the word of God. You would rather be impressed or try to impress men opposed to walking in the power of God. And then he also said when Jesus was getting ready to go through his triumphal entry, and he had then rebuked the people in the synagogue and in the temple, and they came out of the temple, and the disciples looked back at all of the marvelous buildings in Jerusalem, and they said, Jesus, look at all these buildings. Look at these massive buildings. Jesus said to them, not one stone will be left upon another, because this tradition is getting ready to collapse. All this stuff that people has built up as Christianity, somebody say, it's coming down. Yeah, God is getting ready to judge it, because he said the first church is going to have the same type of anointing as the last church. The first shall be last, and the last shall be first. So we are now seeing a movement going back, not simply to the apostolic, but back to the way that church was done from Scripture, not the way that we received it in America. Because the way that we operate as Americans is simply traditionalism. Ain't no power in traditionalism. So we're talking about you can only expect what the roots are to produce the fruit. The root determines the fruit. Everybody say the root determines the fruit. What are you rooted in? What kind of stuff are you producing? He wants to change your DNA, your ability. He wants you to be able to reproduce after your own kind. The reason why we're in trouble right now is because we have reproduced after our own kind. Them children didn't steal that stuff that they're doing. We know where it come from. And the Lord said, I'm getting ready to change your DNA, because I'm getting ready to change your understanding. Because you belong to a body of believers that understand my word, the roots of my word. That you understand that this book is the most powerful book on the planet. It has been battle tested. And I know that there's a lot of different religions coming up, but you can trust my word. This is the root. And the promise to equip the body with these offices were put in place in order that we would not be left powerless in the face of progressive societies. That's the reason why he put the fivefold ministry in place. Because he understood that not only would we be living amongst changing and progressive societies, we'll be moving from one part of the world to the other, and he wanted his word to be able to go with us and to deal with the journey that is ahead of us. The reason why we are still here is because of his word. As a fivefold ministry, we have the ability to relay this message in such a way that it can invade the marketplace if we become the church, because that is the design of it. He said, I sent my word to heal my people. You are going to be the conduit. You are going to be the one that releases this revelation into your community, into your society, so that they can become all that he's created them to be. And without the functionality of these offices, the body is left at the mercy of politicians, philosophers, and pimps. You have no power. If you disregard the five, didn't he tell you that this was the reason why he gave you the fivefold ministry, so that you could be perfected? So if the fivefold ministry is restricted or withheld from you, you can't be perfected. You just got to deal with it. You just got to deal with it the best way that you can. That's the reason why we play lotto, because we don't trust the word. We don't believe that give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together. No, I need to hit the lotto. Don't you know that the lotto is simply a voluntary tax imposed on you? Don't raise your hand. How many of you won the lotto? And what it does, it simply keeps you coming back. You might win it, but you're going to come back. Hard Rock is open not because they expect to lose. There are no windows in Hard Rock. Telling on some of y'all right now. Why are there not windows in Hard Rock? No time. You have no idea what time it is. Talk to me. And your mind is inundated with the bells and the whistles. No windows. No ability. You don't have no idea what time it is. Done spent the whole check. Can't go home. But you got to get out of here. Talk to me up in here. Yeah, and that don't you know that that is a substitution for your tithes? Since you don't trust God, you're going to hit the lotto. How's that working for you? Because look at where that seed is being sown. You better believe it. And boy, we bought the line. I'm trying to get gas. I got to stand in there 30 minutes. Yeah, we got to have our eyes open. Because we being robbed. We are being robbed. Yeah, we have been hoodwinked. Bamboozled. Run amok. Because we're ignorant. We just don't know. And we brag about it. We brag about how drunk we got last night. How are we getting? Because we're ignorant. And we bought into a system that was never designed to perfect us. This is the only system that's going to perfect you. So when we rule out the fivefold ministry, we don't get this kind of revelation. We just become prey to the powers that be. Because nobody is speaking to God's people in order that they might be perfected. So that they can identify the serpent for who he is. And that we're not wrestling against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, and rulers of the darkness of this world. That's why the Democratic Party lost. Because they're stuck in a philosophy that's dead, that it no longer works. Because you're still trying to blame people. Somebody say raise us up. We got to live above this. And it has been judged. This entire system is being judged. Let me hurry up. I feel something that's coming. I'm going to give you three things to expect when you're connected to a fivefold ministry. You can expect this. I don't care where you go to church. If you don't see these three things taking place, not periodically. I'm talking about exclusively. Every time you show up to a fivefold ministry, these are three things that need to be evident. Any other, if you're getting any other type of fruit, then you're operating in tradition. And the first thing is, everybody say strategies. Possessing, and this is what a strategy is, or what strategies are. Possessing the intellectual ability to outmaneuver and outlast that which is in opposition of your divine objective. I'm going to say that one more time. Possessing the intellectual ability, you have to have your mind in place if you're going to be strategic. You don't just show up and expect to be victorious. You got to have a plan. You have to put things together. You have to put things in order. You have to line things up so you can put yourself in a position that's going to cause you to be successful when it's all over. Somebody say strategies. Possessing the intellectual ability to outmaneuver. You need to be able to move when you see the enemy is on the attack. And you need to be able to outlast the enemy also, that and outlast that which is in opposition of your divine objective. Each and everyone under the sound of my voice has a divine objective. God has placed you on this planet for a particular reason. When he created you and he formed you. He fearfully and he wonderfully made you. There is nobody else on this planet like you. But what you need to understand is that the Christian journey, this life that we live as Christians, is not a sprint. Somebody say it's a marathon. Yeah, just because it looked like you victorious today, don't stake your claim to where you are today. That's why we got to stay connected to the body, is because we are running a marathon. When you run a marathon or when you run a relay, you need to be connected to people that can pass the baton on you. When you get tired, some of us get tired a little bit quicker than others, so we need to sprint our way so that we can get to the next leg so we can pass it on to somebody that can take it another further. We're in a marathon. Yeah, just because you didn't run the race as well today as you did yesterday, somebody say, I'm still in the fight. Don't you give up. Don't you quit just because you didn't look as victorious today as you did yesterday. You are not in a sprint. You are in a marathon. And when you look at Jesus' sermons, they were filled with strategies. Jesus had, and the reason being is because Jesus was the mind of God in flesh and blood. He was the very expression of God's word showed up in a man. So woven in his DNA was strategies. Whenever he spoke, strategies came forth. He would show up and he would turn water into wine because he had divine strategies. He would show up and a woman that had an issue of blood for 12 years, she didn't touch him. She touched the hem of his garment. But because there was so much revelation on the inside of him, everything that he touched received the power. Somebody say, receive the power. It comes through the strategy. Somebody say, I need a strategy. What is the stuff that you're going through that you need a strategy right now? That's the reason why you show up Sunday after Sunday, because you need a strategy. Everybody say, I need a strategy. I didn't come here to lose. Yeah, I done been beat up enough. I ain't come to church to get beat up. I need some strategies. If you can't give me no strategy, leave me alone. I done been doing bad all by myself up to this point. If you can't help me out with a strategy, leave me alone. I know how messed up I am. Leave me. I know I don't have it all together. Leave me alone. I need a strategy. If I could help me, I would have helped me a long time ago. The reason why I'm still stuck is because I don't have a strategy. Leave me alone. Stop telling me how jacked up I am. and tradition making you the reason why I'm jacked up. I need a strategy. I need you to show me why you created me to begin with. That's the strategy that I'm looking for. I don't need to be like you. You should be doing a good job at being you, because I'm going to do a good job of being me. And that shouldn't cause any conflict, because I got to pay for this stuff. When you understand the price of the anointing, that's when you stop being jealous of folk. Because whatever they flowing in, yeah, they had to pay for that. God gave them some strategies along the way. They didn't even know how they were going to come out of the stuff that they were in until God gave them a strategy. Kept on tripping over myself before he gave me a strategy. I would rob the church before he gave me a strategy. That was one of my strategies out in the world. I'm going to take it. Not until he gave me a strategy. I was bound to that mindset. That's why some of us still stuck. Because we hadn't received a strategy. We received a whole lot of religion. People telling you that you messed up. And you already know that. I can beat you telling me how messed up I am. Give me something that's going to help me. Yeah, show me how to get up out of this mess. If you got to spit on my eyes, spit on my eyes. Hulk! If I got to go wash down in the pool of Siloam, just whatever. Because I done tried everything else. I done been to a million physicians, and I'm still as messed up now as I was when I started looking for all these answers. Somebody say, give me a strategy. That's why you keep coming back. When you are up on the app, they're going to give you some strategies. You ain't going to leave the same way that you came. I know you might have come in here thinking that you were going to go to Hard Rock. You planning going to Vegas? People robbing you. Doing a good job of it too. They make you funding their perversion look. They make it look good. That you spending your hard-earned money to keep these gangsters in operation. You better believe it. They had a vision. It wasn't the cartels, but it's like the Gambino family, the Italian mafia. They had a vision about Las Vegas. Sin City. And Christian entertainers can't wait to get there. You out your mind. Jesus' sermons were loaded with strategies. And the reason why, this is what you need to understand, the reason why they were loaded with strategies because he was surrounded by people that were hurting. God is not going to give you anything that is not necessary for the moment. But it's not the responsibility of the person that's delivering the word to make you receive the word. You have to diagnose your dilemma. You got to diagnose it. The deliverance is not going to take place through osmosis. Jesus didn't heal anybody that didn't ask for it. Everybody that got healed and delivered, they came looking. How many of you came looking this morning? Lord, look, I got a son, a daughter that's grievously vexed with a devil. I got a son that's dumb and deaf. He throw himself in the fire, in the water. He's a lunatic. You better stop hiding that stuff. You better diagnose that dilemma. If you see it, you better call it out. Baby, I'm dragging you to church because you need to be delivered. I'm going to diagnose this dilemma. I ain't going to act like this stuff ain't happening. I'm seeing some stuff that I know ain't coming from the kingdom. You better diagnose that dilemma. Lord, if I'm blind, Bartimaeus say, I'm blind, Lord, help, open my eyes. And I ain't finna be quiet until he open up my eyes. I know you looking dignified and all wonderful, but I ain't gonna leave until he open up my eyes. I don't mind you being dignified and wonderful as long as you don't mind me crying out. I need my eyes open. Y'all jokers can see. Open my eyes. I'm tired of walking around here listening to how good everything look. Everybody say everything looking. I can't see nothing. Lord, open my eyes. If you blind, say you're blind. There's some deliverance for you if you can own up, if you can diagnose your dilemma. There is, he said, the reason why I can't help you, Pharisee, I can't help you, Sadducee, is because you believe you can see when you're blind. You think you got it all together, so I can't help you. Jesus went back to Capernaum, the place where he growed up, and he couldn't do not one mighty work there because they could only see him as the carpenter's son. They couldn't see him as the Savior. So he couldn't help them because they had already factored him out that he can't help me. You better open up your mouth. If you got a dilemma, if you got something going on in your marriage, you better open up your mouth. Because he's the only one that can heal it. You better cry out. You already know your neighbor can't fix it. Even if they gave you money, money can't fix this one. Matter of fact, the money put us in this predicament in the first place because we begin to trust in mammon. And you are not going to be able to serve both God and mammon at the same time. I need a strategy. Show me how to outmaneuver this enemy. Because that joker got a head start on me. I'm dealing with some stuff he hit me with when I was a baby. Jesus asked the question, how long has this child been going through this? Hey! And then when he ran up on a demoniac, Jesus asked him, what is your name? And the demoniac said, my name is Legion. Because it's a whole lot of us up in here. I got some stuff in here that go generations back. I got some stuff that was passed on to me from some Jacksons, some Smiths, some Rawlinsons, some Dempseys. It's a lot of stuff up in me that I'm carrying. I've been going through what I've been going through for a long time. And they done left me out here. I'm out here in this tomb because I don't know how to deal with all this stuff going on inside of me. See, what is that? What is your name? Yeah, help me identify how I can help you. Jesus came with a strategy. Yeah, you coming out today. Yeah, if you got to go out there in them pigs, you leaving here. You may not have to go to hell, but you're getting out of here. Legion, there's a whole lot of us up in here. That what your husband dealing with? He dealing with legions. Some stuff that hadn't been dealt with that was passed on. He dealing with legions. That what your wife is dealing with. That's why the enemy is trying to destroy your family is because you hadn't dealt with the legions, the stuff that you've been tied to and didn't know that it was still having an effect on you. Somebody say, give me a strategy. I'm coming out of this. Jesus showed up, when he showed up with a sermon, he showed up with strategies. I came to seek and to save those that are lost. I came to open up your blinded eyes so you will no longer be trapped by the same stuff. Your family, your daddy, your mama, your great-grandmama, and your great-great-grand were tied up in. Don't blame them. Don't blame them for the reason why you have these legions. Just understand them. Just understand that they didn't have the revelation that I have, that I'm giving you. So now you go back and you tell them. You go back to the Decapolis. Go back to the 10 cities and let them know what I done for you. You know, if he done anything for you, you ought to tell somebody. Show them that if he done it for me, and y'all know I was up there in them tombs. I was living among dead folk. I was unproductive. And he came and gave me a strategy. This is what he promised us. If we're going to operate out of the apostolic, this is the fruit of it. This is not something strange. You can expect to receive strategies every time you show up. You can expect to be healed because it's in his word. The second thing you're going to need is strength. And the reason why you need strength is because the odds are against you. As a believer, as a Christian in this world, you are in the minority. Especially when you're walking up under the fivefold ministry, because you are a lot more extreme. You see things that other people are not seeing because the Lord is opening up your eyes to more. So you're going to need strength because you're going to find yourself in the minority. And the word strength, this is the definition of it. The ability to bring about a change through unification. What makes us strong is that we stay connected. That's why you got to keep coming back. Because you're going to need strength. This, what you're receiving now, you're going to run out of strength with. This strength that you're receiving now is not going to last you for tomorrow. You're going to need some manna for tomorrow. Jesus said, give us this day. I can't use what I used yesterday for today. It ain't going to work. Somebody say manna. I need some revelation for today. I need some strategies for today. Give us this day our daily bread. He's promising to feed you. Strength. Let me hurry up. Keep y'all here all day. Woo! That's family right there. Boy, look at here. Paul preached so long that the little brother fell out the window. Fell asleep, fell out the window, broke his neck. Woo! Paul had to go down there and revive him. Wake him up. Church out. Everybody stand. You received enough. That's my sign. You are amongst family. You are amongst family. And we enjoy each other. You better believe it. I get it. I get it. Hallelujah. Now, these were the three things that I was going to give you. The strategy, the strength, and stability. Stability. You need stability. The only way that you can be stable is by being connected to people that are more stable than you. You are not in this thing by yourself. And once you get connected, the fivefold ministry brings a level of stability that you can't get anywhere else. So we need strategies, we need to be strengthened, and we need stability. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we come and we say thank you for what our eyes have seen and what our ears have heard. And we pray that you continue to empower us to become allow us to be the byproduct of the fivefold ministry. That everywhere that we go, we represent what it means to be a person that's filled with strategies. What it means to be a person that's filled with strength, and what it means to be a person that's filled with stability. Because our families are in danger. Because we are in the minority. And what this world has put up, the method that they are using, the method they are using are producing witches, warlocks, whores and homosexuals, coons and buffoons. So, Father, we thank you for your word that will open our eyes so we will not become prey to the methods of this world, because you've given us these five gifts, the apostle, the prophet, the pastor, the teacher, and the evangelist, in order that they might equip us so we can be fit for battle. So I thank you for what you're doing right now in the lives of your people and how you're creating a hunger within them. So that they'll come, they'll continue to search out ways to get connected to you so that they can continue to receive the strategies that's going to make them better. We thank you for families being healed right now. We thank you for broken hearts being mended even right now. We thank you for the beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for the spirit of mourning. And a high expectation of who we are, because you told us you've given us these gifts so we can be perfected. So we thank you for the perfection that's taking place right now. And we thank you for the lives that are going to be impacted because we are being made perfect, because we stand up under the guidelines of your rules and regulations of the word. We don't try to explain away what you have already revealed. We receive it right now in the name of Jesus. So, Father, we thank you, we honor you, and we love you. It is in the mighty name of Jesus that I pray. Let all the sons and daughters of God say amen. Amen. Let's give God a hand clap of praise.
Joining us today at Sanctuary of Hope Worship Ministries. We hope you enjoy the service. We look forward to seeing you next Sunday at 9:30 Landon Foundation class, following our morning worship at 10:30. Every Wednesday we have Bible study at 7 o'clock. We would like for you to connect with us on social media, on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. God bless you. Hope to see you again next Sunday.
Invite you out to our Foundations class, which begins at 9:30 every Sunday morning from 9:30 to 10:15. The Foundations class is designed to do three things, and that is provide for everyone that walks through the doors at Sanctuary of Hope purpose, passion, and perseverance. We look to see you there.